Praise the Lord, church. We're going to be singing a song that is fun. We like fun songs, but there's some words in here, there's some phrases in here that I think lose meaning when we're singing them if we don't define them a little bit. Who knows what the word hail means? Hail. It's the round things that fall from the sky. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about giving a claim. What's a claim? Exactly. What is a claim? A claim is enthusiastic and public praise. So when we talk about hailing someone, we're talking about giving them all of our enthusiastic and public praise. So we're going to be hailing the Lion of Judah. And someone's going to be talking about who the Lion of Judah is and all what that means. But my thing is also going to talk about when we're talking about preparing the way. If you were here in Sunday school, I was like, oh, go, Pastor. Go. Because here's why. When we prepare the way, in Isaiah 40, it's talking about someone in the wilderness preparing the way. And we find out in Mark that that's talking about John. But we've been given that ministry of preparation. So when we're talking about what we should be doing, the prophet Isaiah writes that we should be making the mountains come down, and we should be making the valleys come up, and we should make the straight even more straight. We should make the curve straight as well. And it hit me that this is really kind of, think about what happened to America when we made the highway system, right? We completely scarred the landscape and allowed access. So when we prepare the way of the Lord, when we hail Jesus and publicly declare him, it's a daily choice on our end to allow that transformation to happen.
So then, right, she's talking about the scars, and I'm going to be talking about who we celebrate today. We're celebrating the mighty Savior, right? He's defeated sin and death, and yeah, that's great, and that's awesome. But first, there was a sacrifice here. And I like it. I love it in Revelation 5:5 because we see him as the Lion of Judah, right? Where we see him as this great and mighty lion. And in Revelation, John sees this lion, and he's like, oh, yeah, do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has triumphed. But when John's looking toward the victor, he's looking for the lion, he doesn't see the lion. He sees a lamb that had been scarred and suffered. And he says this, then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne. Because before Jesus could rise as the victor, he had to first humble himself and be sacrificed as that lamb, just like Isaiah prophesied. He said he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. He was quiet. He died and was buried as the perfect sacrificial lamb, but he arose as the triumphant Lion of Judah.
And I'm going to be talking about that triumphant Lion of Judah. In Revelations 5:5, the writer says, and I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who was worthy to open the book and who is worthy to loose the seals thereof? And no man in heaven nor on earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look therein. And I wept because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, nor to look at it. And one of the elders said to me, weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals whereof. And then I'm going to skip down. And I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne and the beasts and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. When I start looking into a lion, what we all know, he's an apex predator. He doesn't have many enemies in our world. A lion's roar can be heard for 5 miles. And there was a study done that a lion's roar is at a certain decibel, and it can stun its prey to just make it stand frozen in their tracks. And I looked at why a lion, because a lion is the protector of the pride. The lionesses, they hunt. He's not really the hunter, but he is the protector. And his roar goes out, and he lets all the lions in 5 miles, don't come near this place, because I've got this under my protection. And when we hear the roar of Christ, it's his protection over us. It's his dominion, his conquering spirit. He has conquered. He has already conquered the things in this world for us. And that's what we're going to be singing about. Hallelujah. And make sure you worship with this one. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
God of Jacob, great I am, King of angels, Son of man, voice of many waters, song of heaven's throne, louder than the thunder, make your glory known. Let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah. Let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah. Let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah. Let the lion roar. Zion, prophet spoke, our Messiah, flesh and bone, you alone are worthy to open up the scroll. Like a lamb you suffered, but the lion has a roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah, let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah, let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah, let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah, let the lion roar. Prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way, prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord. Roar. Judah, let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah, let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah, let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah, let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah, let the lion roar. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah, let the lion roar.
Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way. Prepare the way of the Lord. O valley, be raised up. O mountain, be made low. O valley, be raised up. O mountain, be made low.
On the hill of Calvary, my Savior bled for me, and my Jesus, he set me free.
Look at the wounds that give me life, grace flowing from his side, no greater sacrifice. The glory and the honor to the Son. My sins are forgiven. My future is heaven. I praise God for what he's done.
Save for the freedom he has won. Even death is
heaven. I praise God for what
I was a wretch, and I remember who I was. For I was lost, I was blind, and I was running out of time.
Sin separated, the breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your side. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross, you paid the debt I owe. Broke my chain.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give him praise. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. It's good to be in the house of God today. Amen. Amen. To feel the power of God working in this place and to remember what he's done for us. I mean, God is so good. I've got a couple of scriptures I want to bring to you this morning as we start things off. If you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to Matthew chapter 24. We'll then be going to 2 Corinthians 11. Matthew chapter 24. I'll give you a moment to get there. It will be on the screen. Unless those days were shortened, no one would be saved. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be shortened. Then if anyone says to you, look, here is Christ, or there he is, do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will arise and show great signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect. Listen, I've told you beforehand. And then 2 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 12, Paul writes, and what I am doing, I will continue to do in order to undermine the claim of those who would like to claim that in their boasted mission, they work on the same terms as we do. For such men are false apostles, deceitful workmen, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. So it is no surprise if his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness. Their end will correspond to their deeds. I want to talk to you for just a short while this morning, and I know this is not a traditional Easter message, but that's okay. If you were here for Sunday school, you got that. Amen. Yes. But I want to talk to you for a while this morning about this subject. Avoid the cheap substitutions. Amen. Amen. Let's pray to God one more time. Lord Jesus, we love you. We praise you, and we pray, God, that you would have your way in this place. Lord Jesus, let your spirit minister to every heart that's in this place. Let the power of your word go forth and change lives. We love you, Lord. We praise you, and we thank you for your presence. We ask this in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. Amen. You may be seated. Again, not taking long this morning, but I want to talk to you about this idea of alternatives, substitutions, and imitations. Because they are certainly out there and looking for anybody who wants to find them. These knockoffs and counterfeits remind me of when I was overseas. Almost every city that you walk into has a common market, and you go to that common market and you will find somebody that's there on one of the corners with a blanket laid out, and they've got all their wares there, and they will sell you a Coach handbag and a Rolex watch. $15 each, or both of them for $25. Yeah. Now, it might look good at first, right? And it kind of looks sort of like the real thing, but if you look closely, yeah, you're not getting what you're paying for. As a matter of fact, if you were to open up that Rolex watch, there might not be anything inside the case, but man, doesn't it look good on my wrist? Right, so why is, and these people are there day after day after day. Why is that? Because people are buying their stuff. Because people, even though they know, now anybody in their right mind has at least an inkling that if it sounds too good to be true, it probably is. But yet still people will go ahead and put their money down for these cheap imitations, these counterfeits, these substitutes. Why is that? Because they're not willing to pay the price for the real thing. They want the benefits, but they don't want the cost. They want someone to look at me and say, whoa, he's wearing a Rolex. He must be doing all right. He must have a lot of money in the bank and power, prestige. He must be somebody that to be reckoned with because of what I'm wearing on my wrist. But that's what they want to impart. Or that lady that's got the Coach bag and carrying that thing around. Wow, she's got money to burn, right? I know Coach isn't, I'm dating myself. I know Coach is passe. I get that, okay? But bear with me. You hear what I'm saying, right? You're picking up what I'm laying down here. There's substitutes. There's cheap substitutes that people will spend their hard-earned money on because they just don't feel like they're willing to put out what it costs for the real deal. In Luke chapter 9, Luke writes,
And this is Jesus speaking. The Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. We've heard that before this morning. Then he said to them, verse 23, if anyone will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whosoever will save his life will lose it, but whosoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world, yet loses or forfeits himself? And in another gospel, those words say, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his own soul? Yet there are people that are out there looking for cheap substitutes, looking for a path to God that won't cost them anything. When Jesus tells you there's a cost involved, you can't have it both ways. You can't live in the world and love the things of the world and say, I'm a Christian, I love God. It's incompatible. It's oil and water. It does not mix. There is a cost to be paid to be a Christian. Now, to be a Christian, to truly be a Christian, brings those benefits that we talked about in Sunday school. It brings the gift of eternal life, and not only that, it brings peace of mind in this current world. People want those benefits, but they're not willing to pay the price. They're not willing to repent. And that's another one of those words, right, that we repent. It's simple. It's just turning. It's turning away from the path that you're going down and turning toward God. It's saying, God, I know that I'm not living the way that you would like me to live, so I'm going to do everything I can do to try to do things your way. That's what repenting's all about. Knowing what the right thing to do is and giving it your best shot to do it, knowing that none of us have the strength to do that. Right. That's why Jesus died on the cross. Right. I mean, he was sinless because we can't be. Because our human nature is such that we cannot be who he was. We cannot be that sinless sacrifice. But he made a way for us to overcome that deficit. He made a way for us if we will turn toward him and give him what we can. Right, taking up our cross daily. That means, again, dying to sin. We're dead to sin, that's repentance. That means, I know that that's not the right way to go, so I'm not gonna go that way. I know what the Bible tells me, and I'm gonna give it my best shot to do what God wants me to do. It's that simple. God, forgive me for not being who you've called me to be, and help me, God, to be more like you. It's not hard. Again, I mentioned it in Sunday school. It's a pretty simple message, isn't it? But it costs. It costs us as human beings because we've got to make that choice and we've got to turn away from things that the world has told us are valuable. I'm here to tell you that those things that are valuable in the world are no better than that Rolex watch without the guts inside it. It's no better than that Armani suit that has the label sewn in upside down and spells Armani with a Y. I'm telling you that the world is full of cheap substitutes, that it wants to pawn off on you and make you kind of feel like they can make everything all right. But they're not going to make everything all right. There's only one that has the answer for your life. There's only one that can give you peace of mind in the worst of situations. Amen. And that's Jesus Christ, our Lord. There's a story in 1 Kings chapter 12. After the kingdom of Israel was split between the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. And we find the king there, the leader of the nation of Israel, the northern kingdom, saying, look, if we allow the people to go back to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover, they're going to get reconciled and they're going to align themselves with the throne of David again. And it's going to bring the whole kingdom back together and we're going to lose our power. We're going to lose our place. We're going to lose our political clout. And so here's what we're going to do. We're going to fashion a couple of golden calves and we're going to set them up. One on a mountain in Dan and one of them on a mountain in Bethel. And the people can go there to worship. They won't have to go to Jerusalem. Again, cheap substitutes. God had ordained the place of worship. He told them where they were to gather and worship. And yet they were coming up with these substitutes to satisfy themselves, amen, to deceive the people and make the people think that they were all right. Well, they weren't all right. Amen. And they were told to go to this mountain one of the reasons, no doubt, that they chose Bethel is because of the experience that Jacob had on that mountain. It was that place where Jacob was dreaming and dreamed of a ladder ascending and descending into heaven, and he saw angels ascending and descending on the ladder. And he woke up and he said, "Surely the presence of the of God is in this place." He had an awesome, powerful experience with God in that place. But just because there's an experience there doesn't mean that's the final destination. And a lot of people are kind of deceived into having an experience with God. They kind of they latch on, they feel God's presence and they think, okay, this must be it. I've got everything that God has for me. That is not always the case. I mean, I'm thinking of substitutes and imitations. And one of the things that comes to mind, I grew up in the Catholic Church. And from a young person all the way through, went through my first communion and confirmation. And oh, by the way, after that, I was like, okay, you're done. And I was just kind of off on my own and only went to church for weddings and funerals after that. It's kind of weird. But as a child, I went to Catholic masses regularly. And I didn't realize it until afterwards when I started to really dig into the Bible that everything in that Catholic Mass and Catholic Church is really patterned around temple worship, the Jewish temple. I mean, to where when you walk in, they've got a little bowl of what they call holy water. It's blessed water where you anoint yourself. And just like the laver that was there in front of the temple that God had instituted. They've got incense that they burn, just like the table of incense. They've got a sacrifice. The way they do communion is meant to be a reenactment of a sacrifice. And so everything that they do is kind of patterned. Even the priest's garb is patterned after that Jewish temple worship. And I'm not trying to bash them at all, because I grew up in that and I built a relationship with God in that place. But that's not where God wanted me to stay. You see, there's a lot of people that have experiences with God. It might be an experience that you have listening to somebody on the radio or watching somebody on the television. It might be a church that you used to go to growing up where you actually experienced God. God is real, and God can meet you anywhere that you are. And he can touch your heart and let you know that he's real. But just because you have an experience with God doesn't mean it's time to stop. That's when it's time to grow. That's when it's time to learn more about him. That's when it's time to get real with God. Amen. And don't satisfy yourself with cheap imitations. You want the real deal. You want God in your life. You want the power of God, the creative power of God, the resurrecting power of God. God is a spirit. And we need to worship him with everything that we have. And he will meet you wherever you are, wherever your need is. He will meet you right there. I mean, those imitations of religious tradition that the Catholic Church has brought about, those were never meant to go beyond the cross. Those were all pointing to things in the future. The incense that they send up, that's meant to be a symbol of the prayers of the saints going up to heaven. I meant to worship him. The laver is meant to signify when we're baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And it washes our sins away. It cleanses us of our sins. It's the blood that Jesus, amen, applies to our life, amen, and makes us clean and whole. God is awesome. God is miraculous. He's a miracle-working God, amen. And he's not about signs and symbols. He's about personal relationships. God, it's yes, we gather together, and certainly we've got this kind of liturgy that we go through, right? You can, if you come here long enough, you'll kind of get the pattern down. We come in, right? We sing a song, and then somebody reads scripture, and then somebody, you know, we sing some more songs, and we do prayer, we do our offering, we have a sermon. Yeah, we've got a kind of pattern that we follow, and that's okay to have an order. But you know what? Sometimes God interrupts that order, and that's okay. Because it's not about the tradition and it's not about the ceremony. It's about the presence and the power of God in this place. Amen. And when we worship him, when we lift our voices up to him, I don't know if you felt it, but I felt it, that there's this power, this essence, this presence of God that's right here, and he can make himself close to you. He can let you know what? I'm real and I'm here if you need me. Again, he's not going to reach down and yank you up out of your chair and make you lift your hands, or he's not going to make words come out of your mouth. But God is here and available to you. And if you want to just acknowledge who he is, he'll get even closer to you.
Yes.
Amen. He'll get as close to you as you want to be.
Yes.
Amen. Our God is a gentleman. He's not going to force himself on you, but he wants to have a relationship with you. He wants to be close to you. He doesn't want to be the object that's far away, the object of your worship. He wants to be right there with you each and every day, not just inside these four walls, but each and every day when something comes your way, when you've got troubles or trials that come your way, God can be there to comfort you. You can just kind of take a deep breath and realize, God's here. It's all right. Amen. I distinctly remember feeling that after I was born again, that as I was going through nicotine withdrawals, for one thing, that I could just kind of breathe in and realize God's here. I don't need that. And I'll just leave it at that. But there were a lot of other things, amen, that I was dealing with at the time that God allowed me to let go of because he let me know, I'm here for you. I'm here for you, and this is real. God is so good. Amen. So again, God gave us all of those things of the sanctuary, all those patterns that he gave to us were a pattern of things to come, the Bible tells us. In Colossians, it says that they're shadows of the things to come. But the substance, Paul writes, belongs to Christ. And I'm talking about substance today, not cheap substitutes, but substance. So this idea of religious traditions and not knowing exactly, you know, how to deal with God, how to worship God, it's nothing new. If you go to John chapter 4, there's a story there of the woman at the well, and you can read it for yourself, how that Jesus is there at a well in Samaria, and he meets this woman that comes up, and he's kind of going back and forth with her, ministering to her, and she doesn't even know it. And then when she finally realizes, he's kind of, he knows me a little bit too well. This guy is a prophet or something. She then blurts out to him, look, our fathers, the Samaritans, tell us we're supposed to worship on this mountain, right? Think Dan and Bethel. But your people, the Jews, you say you got to worship at Jerusalem. So she's basically asking Jesus, how do I sort all of this out? There's so many mixed messages. Every place I turn to, every corner I go on, there's another church. Who do I believe? What does Jesus tell her? That the Father isn't looking toward this mountain or toward Jerusalem, but he's looking for true worshipers. He's looking for people that will worship him in spirit and in truth. Amen. I'm not telling you to walk in the door of any church and you're okay. I'm not telling, but what I am telling you is that it doesn't matter what that church is or what the sign on the outside is. What matters to you is the relationship that you have with God right in here. Amen. If you can worship God in spirit and in truth, if you can allow the Spirit of God to minister, to actually enter inside of you, to drive your behavior, to help you navigate this world, if you can read God's word and believe it, that it's true, that it's life-giving, that it can change your life, amen, and you can worship him in that spirit and truth, you can do that anywhere. Anywhere. I mean, you can do that in your car, you can do that in your home, you can do that on your job. God is with you. I mean, that's why he came. Emmanuel, God with us. He came here so that he could make himself available to us, amen. You don't have to be confused about religion, because it's not about religion. Amen. It's about relationship. God wants to have a relationship with you. He doesn't want our relationship with him to be built upon some spiritual guessing game. Right? It's not complicated. But the world again is full of counterfeits. And what the world will try to do is to trap you in this little loop of these commercial counterfeits for God. I mean, the spiritual counterfeits, excuse me, they're just as bad as the commercial counterfeits that are there in the market. and they're looking for vulnerable people. And this is a spiritual battle that I'm talking about here, all right? There's people in the world that are maybe even have a good heart and are trying to help people, that think they're helping people. But if they're hindering someone's relationship with God, it's not doing them any good whatsoever. Amen. Because the true power comes from your relationship with God. There's other people that are definitely trying to take advantage of you. And I hearken back to my days from the military. Outside of every military installation, I defy you to find one where you could go from within a half mile of the gate before you find a sign on a used car lot that says, bad credit, no problem. Because they know that Uncle Sam is giving you a paycheck and they know they're going to get their money. Oh, you might have to go without food for a few weeks, but you're going to pay them for that vehicle. That's how it is in the spiritual realm as well. I mean, there's a lot of people that will try to take advantage of you in the spirit. You got to take this thing to its full conclusion in your life, the reality of God in your life and building a relationship with Him, not relying on religion, not relying on tradition. This is kind of funny. You know how a song kind of comes to you and takes up residence in your brain, a song from long ago, right? This whole sermon this morning was kind of spawned by such a thing a couple of weeks ago. Told my wife about it and didn't know exactly what it was about at the time, but I'm walking around the house and this song is kind of going through my brain, and it's not a song that we sing in song service, although it could be with a few minor changes. So I'm going around and when I think of the words of this song, and you'll know it as soon as I'm not going to sing it, but it's hard to even say it without the melody, right? Making your way in the world today takes everything you got. Everybody knows it, right? Almost everybody in this place. Cheers. Yeah, hello. Taking a break from all your worries sure would help a lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? Yeah. And it's a cute little ditty. It is. It is. Sometimes you want to go where everybody knows your name, where they're always glad you came. You want to be where you can see our troubles are all the same. You want to be where everybody knows your name. And this is what I thought about when I'm thinking, man, that you could apply this to church in a way. But then I thought about it, and they're using this kind of lighthearted this theme song for a lighthearted sitcom, right? And this cast is all smiles. And you can go down to the Boston Common and walk around the west side of the garden and see right there the awning that says Cheers, right? It's a basement bar. And what this show did was kind of show that, well, okay, if you got problems in your life, all you got to do is just spend every waking minute outside of work at this bar, right? It showed a group of people that were just as happy as a clam, but they were miserable. It didn't show you that part of it, did it? It didn't show you the troubles and the trials. When you find somebody, I challenge you to find somebody that is in a bar after work and stays there until closing on a regular basis, and show me anyone like that that's got joy in their life. They're miserable. They're looking for an answer. They're looking for something that they can't get from this world, and that's where they're looking. I'm talking about cheap substitutes this morning. Amen. What they're trying to sell you with this song and with this sitcom is that, oh, you know what? All you need is a time of fellowship with a group of like-minded friends that all have the same troubles. That's not the message that God has for you. God doesn't want you to commiserate with people and share your misery with others. God wants you to be released from that misery. He wants you to gather together in a place like this, amen, where your troubles and trials can be laid down at an altar, where you can walk away free from those things, where you can feel peace in your heart, amen, where you can feel this weight that's been lifted from you. And that's what the real deal is all about. That's what the world tries to substitute for time and time and time again. People are looking all over the place by hundreds of thousands of people that are spiritually hungry, that trying to fill that void inside each and every one of us when we were separated way back. When mankind was separated from God in the garden, it left a void inside us, inside each and every one of us, that this world cannot fill. Right. And there's a place inside us where we think to ourselves, why am I here? What's the purpose? What is this life really all about? God's the only one that can answer those questions. God is the only one that can fill that void for you. And I'm telling you that if you allow God to, you don't need to find yourself in a basement bar. You don't need to go out and try to find happiness in the bottom of a beer stein or in drugs or alcohol or in relationship after relationship after relationship. Amen. That's what the world has given as cheap substitutes to fill that spiritual void. But I'm here to tell you that God wants to fill that void in your life today. Amen. And He is able to do so. He can change your life. Amen. There are no answers to be found, amen, in this world. The world will turn things upside down. Every single day, it's trying to pull you into this idea that you can't do it on your own. You need help, and we're here to help, says the world. And you can fill in the blank there, whether that is the alcohol industry, whether that is Hollywood, whatever it is, whether it's politics. They're all trying to give you an answer that will take care of you, answer your questions, and make you feel better about yourself. Trying to make you who God wants you to be, but they can never do it. Only God can make you who God wants you to be. Amen. We've all got troubles. We've all got trials. We do. It happens. Even when you're born again into the kingdom of God, we still have troubles and trials. We still have those mountains and valleys. Amen. But thank God we have the Spirit of God inside us. Amen. And that allows us, amen, not just to tear down the mountains that are in front of us and to lift up the valleys to bridge that gap in the time of trial, but allows us, amen, those who have that relationship with God, those who have built that relationship and are filled with His Spirit, that makes us, amen, able to prepare the way for others. Amen, that we can go forth. Amen, we can be that voice in the wilderness. Amen, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God, Isaiah said. Every mountain and hill shall be brought low. Every valley shall be exalted. Amen, we can do that for the world. Amen, we can be what the world really needs. That's what the church is all about. That's what God wants the church to be. And it's not just outside these walls, amen. There's a lot of people that aren't in church today, and they need to be. They need to know that God loves them and wants to build a relationship with them and wants to make their life better. But even here amongst us, there's people that are having troubles and trials. And that's where that idea of being together comes in. A place where we can all get together, where we all know each other, where we can feel that we can be sensitive to the needs of each other and minister to each other. That's the beauty of being in a Spirit-filled church, amen, where you can be loved, where you can feel like your family, amen. You can have that same thing that the world wants to substitute in a basement bar. You can have all the goodness of that without the bad part, right? It sounds like an alcohol-free beer commercial, but it's absolutely true. You can have the good part, amen, and throw away the bad, amen. This is not a cheap substitute that I'm talking about, amen. This is God's Spirit living inside you, making you whole. God is awesome, and He wants to do that for you. Praise God. Praise God. So I'm here to warn you, if you run across those that might be trying to steer you down a different path to tell you everything's going to be all right. Absolutely. God is the one that's your answer. Amen. In Colossians, I've got a fairly lengthy passage that I want to read out here that Paul brings to us in Colossians. And it's an awesome, powerful book that he writes. I'm going to read it in the New Living from Colossians chapter 2. It comes across as a beautiful tale that he's written to each and every one of us. Don't let anyone capture you with empty philosophies or high-sounding nonsense that come from human thinking and from spiritual powers of this world rather than from Christ. For in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. So you are also complete through your union with Christ, who is the head over every ruler and authority. When you came to Christ, you were circumcised, but not with a physical procedure. Christ performed a spiritual circumcision, cutting away your sinful nature. For you were buried with Christ when you were baptized, and with him you were raised to new life because you trusted the mighty power of God who raised Christ from the dead. You were dead because of your sins and because of your sinful nature. And because it was not cut away, then God made you alive with Christ, for he forgave all our sins. He canceled the record of charges against us and took it away by nailing it to the cross. In this way, he disarmed the spiritual rulers and authorities. He shamed them publicly by his victory over them on the cross. Amen. God is able to give you what this world cannot give you. Amen. And if you stick around this place long enough, you'll feel the power of God in your life. And I'll just finish up with this with Acts chapter 2, which is again, it's a beautiful portrait that's painted in God's word about people that were confounded when the truth just smacked them in the face. Mm-hmm. The Bible tells us that when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all, talking about the apostles of Jesus, his disciples, not just the 12 apostles, but his disciples, some 120 people. They were all, the Bible tells us, with one accord in one place. They got together just as Jesus told them. They were gathered there in Jerusalem in this upper room, and they were praying. God, you promised us something. You promised that we were going to get power. We don't know what that's all about, but here we are. We love you, and we're just waiting for you, God, to do your thing in our lives. So the day of Pentecost is fully come. They're gathered in that place, and all of a sudden it says there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house there where they were sitting, and there were cloven tongues like as a fire that sat upon each of them, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen. They were filled with the Spirit of God. They started speaking in tongues. People were gathered around wondering what's going on here, and it's curious what they say. They see all this going on, and some of them said, wow, this is wild. What's going on here? And other people said, they're drunk. They thought it was a cheap substitute until Peter stood up and said, no, they're not drunk. This is what the prophet Joel was talking about. In the last days, God said, I'm going to pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. And then Peter started to tell them what had transpired. We're the disciples of Jesus Christ, and it wasn't that long ago, just a few short weeks, that you crucified the Messiah. Jesus was, in fact, the one who was promised to us in the Old Testament. He lived on this earth. He was the power of God embodied in a human being, and yet you took that human and nailed him to a cross. You crucified him, the Messiah, and they thought about that, and it really bothered them, and they said, what shall we do? And then Peter stood up and said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. The promises unto you and to your children and to all that are afar off. I'm talking about the real deal this morning. You want the power of God in your life? Repent of your sins. Turn to God. Amen. If you look inside yourself, if you look in your spiritual mirror and you see that you're not measuring up to God, obviously, and that there are things that you need to change in your life, it's time to turn and start heading toward God. And that's repentance. That's all that is. It's coming to a place where you can say, God, forgive me. I know I need you and I need your help. I need your help to be who you've called me to be. And if you haven't been baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, I can't tell you how empowering that is. Yep. And I was baptized as a baby in the Catholic Church with a little water sprinkled on my head when I was, you know, just weeks old, if not months old. And frankly, that didn't do anything but sprinkle a little water on my head. But when I learned about this message, this true message from God, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and I was baptized in the name of Jesus as an adult, and I knew what I was doing, I came up out of that water and I felt this weight that was just lifted from me. I felt like a new person. My sins had been washed away. God changed my life. It was just a week later that from when I received God's Spirit that I had this baptism experience, and I was made complete. I was made whole. God washed my sins away. And he can do that for you if that hasn't happened in your life. Amen. God has made this available to everybody. You don't have to look to the world. Amen. I'm here to tell you that God is able. Stand with me this morning. I'll end with a passage from Romans. In Romans chapter 12, Paul writes, I urge you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service of worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. God has a purpose and a plan for every single person. He does. And he wants you to take your mind and allow his spirit to transform you. Amen. He wants you to take all of the thoughts of this world just away, cast them aside. Any troubles, any trials, any worries that you have, just push them aside and focus on God for a moment. And I'm going to ask you to do that right now. As a matter of fact, if you would just close your eyes and bow your head, I'm going to ask you to take a moment of repentance. I don't care if you've been born again and been in church for 40 years, you need to repent this morning. You need to think about the way that you live your life, the things that you do, the things that might not be pleasing to God, and ask for God's forgiveness. Ask God to forgive you and to help you with those areas. Reach out to him and just let him know that you want to serve him, that you love him, that you feel his power and his presence, and you want more of him. And if you need the power of God in your life, the Spirit of God in your life, if you feel like things might be a little bit out of control and this world is chewed you up and spit you out, there's troubles that you have, or there's worries that you have, there's fears that you have, I'm going to ask you to come forward and just spend some time talking to God. And these altars are open, and I'm not telling you that only those that haven't been born again. If you've been born again and you need a closer relationship with God, come on up here. If you have never received the Spirit of God in your life, if you've never spoken in other tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance, that can happen in this place today. You can have the same experience that those disciples did on the day of Pentecost. God wants to change you today. He wants to change you for the better. And he wants you to not have to turn to the world for a cheap substitute. He wants to pour out the real deal in this place today. And so as you have repented of your sins, I would ask you to just lift up your hands and thank God for who he is. Thank God for the sacrifice, especially on this day, right? Thank him for the sacrifice that he made and for that clear path that he's laid before you, that path that leads directly to heaven. He's done that for you. He's made that available to you. Amen. The message that Jesus came to preach was the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That means it's available. As far as you can reach, that's how close heaven is. John the Baptist preached the exact same message. When Jesus sent his disciples out from town to town, he gave them the exact same message. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. God's kingdom, God's presence is available to you right now, right here. Reach out to him today and thank him for that. Amen. When you're done with repenting, put that away. Leave every weight, amen, aside. Leave every worry, leave every care, and just lift your hands and give God praise. Ooh.